There we go. G'day, Richard. How are you going?
Hello, Peter. I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. Last session for the festival, and I don't know if we're going to have many people, but I think a lot of people, oh, we've got a couple more. A lot of people think the festival's now over, so having done the big dance.
Oh, we've got a couple of things to do.
I've been looking forward to giving this one, but I've also been a little bit ginger about it because we get to talk about some gory details that once upon a time were very politically sensitive in Australia. And now I think we've enough time has passed that I can actually discuss these two case studies and then...
Yeah, that's the thing I always find. It's like, I could give so much information, but you can't give the context to which that information lies.
Yeah, well, given we're talking about stuff that happened 2009 through to 2014, we can give enough context that I don't think anyone's going to be offended. The dust has settled. And we've got two beautiful outcomes for really large organizations that came from small beginnings. So I think we're in a good place. Let's see. And we've got at least one of the players is on. G'day. Let's see. Lejana is, she's still connecting to her audio. That's okay. Lejana was at CBA during some of the goings on. So hello, everyone. We're going to have a lovely little session, I think. We're going to basically work through why pull transformation exists as a concept, at least from my perspective, and two of the major case studies for it in Australia. We've got stuff going on at the moment using pull transformation in many places around the world, but the lovely thing, as Richard and I were just discussing about these two cases, is that they happened long enough ago that we can actually give blow-by-blow gory details without embarrassing people. There are two people I'm going to call Manager X and Manager Y at CBA, and I'm calling them that because one of them is a recent or current CEO of the entire banking group, but wasn't back in the day. And the other one was his right-hand man back then and is currently, I think, CIO for one of the divisions of the bank. So they'll remain Manager X and Manager Y, but otherwise we'll name names and give credit where it's due. And we won't make people into villains because no one's a villain, but we'll talk about some of the things that happened. And then the second part of this is going to be about actual guidance. How do you go about running a pull transformation? The funny thing is that although, at least as far as I'm concerned, I've never seen or heard of another form of transformation that has actually worked. There's very little in the literature on pull transformation. Most is about this dreadful idea that you're going to parachute in dozens of certified creatures and that everyone's going to change at once and somehow magically you're not going to wind up in a ditch. And in practice, this simply doesn't work. It leads to dreadful disruptions and compromise and so on. But let's take things back to the dawn of time. And I should say, I'm recording. I encourage everyone to share video and share audio, unless you've got background noise on, I'd love to hear how things strike you. I really want you to step up and go, no, Pete, you're full of crap. Because usually I am, or at least often, depending on how much credit you want to give me. And really what I'm looking for is for people to object. If you happen to have been involved in these two cases, then eject really strenuously, and hopefully we'll all learn something, because the whole idea here is to share learning. That's been the beautiful thing about the Agile 20 Festival. It's really been reinvigorating a principle that is very different to Shuhari. Shuhari, this idea that, well, you can't really share learning until you become some gray-haired old dude. Well, usually dude, that's just silly. It's ridiculous.
Was that a pun?
It is possibly. Muhinshu is where both Muhinshu and Shuhari come from Japanese tea. Muhinshu was the original principle of tea. That's why Japanese tea is so different from other kinds of tea service and other kinds of tea for that matter. It's the same tea plant, but it's just prepared and served differently. And the reason it's done differently is because of Muhinshu, which is literally no host, no guest, which is to say no teacher, no student. We're all here to share learning. So when you hear me say something preposterous or even just dubious, do please pipe up and keep me honest. So I'm one of the 12 patrons of the festival. So this is my sixth or seventh festival session. I'm not sick of it. I think this has been brilliant. And I really wish that the festival would just keep going. In Australia in 1973, there was a sort of a Woodstock style festival called the Aquarius Festival that happened in a sleepy little dairy town called Nimbin. And it's still going. The entire counterculture in Australia spawned from this festival, and it's led to, amongst other things, the global permaculture movement. So I don't see why we should stop. But I'm not running the festival. I'm only a patron. What do I know?
So we can talk about this on the.
Sorry, go on.
We're going to talk about this on the 7th of March, and I'm sure you're going to be invited.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are driving, pushing towards not stopping. So.
Yeah.
And I'm sad I only attended three of your sessions. I didn't know you held six or seven. I'm going to be very sad now.
Well, happily they're all recorded, so. So you've got a little bit of extra joy, I hope. But let's get into the meat of the matter, because otherwise people on the recording will go, oh God, there he goes again. So I have been involved in Agile since before it was called Agile. I spoke at the very first Agile conference, which was called XP 2000, held in 2000. At the end of that conference, a bunch of us got together and said this little stand up in the Mediterranean. Uncle Bob, Martin Fowler, Kent Beck, Ron Jeffries, Don Wells, who else was there? Alistair Coburn, both Dave Thomases. Dave Thomas, the shorter Dave Thomas. I used to say Dave Thomas the rounder, but I think he's actually the skinnier these days. Anyway, Dave turned up with this pamphlet from Rational. It said that the Rational Unified Process will now do XP. And he said, if we don't rebrand this thing quick, guys, if we keep calling it Extreme, it's just going to be another flavor of rock. We've got to do something about this. And my recollection is that's where this word Agile was born. And I reckon Alistair came up with it. He swears that it was Mike. A poor Mike Beadle, who unfortunately passed away a couple of years ago under very terrible circumstances. And I'm perfectly happy to give kudos to Mike. But anyway, that was certainly where Agile began. As far as I was concerned, that was about 9 months before Snowbird. I had run the second XP program in the world. But I wasn't interested in Agile at the time as a force for good. I was involved in startups. And then I was involved in a startup that crashed spectacularly after about 2.5 years. It was probably the best startup I was ever involved in, but it wound up with the CEO suing the founder for the IP and the founder counter-suing, and the whole thing went into court. I opened a tea house in Australia in the rainforest in Tweedshire. And I spent a couple of years serving tea, and I'm still very fond of the stuff today. And after a while, I remarried, because that startups also sort of saw off my first marriage. Startups can be stressful things, at least that one was, but it was so good. Anyway, we're not going to talk about that. So when that crashed and burned, I went to the rainforest. I really kind of felt like, oh, I'm out. I can relax now. It's time for a bit of semi-retirement. I'm going to do other things. Well, I remarried and there was a child and I had to support a child, and I couldn't support a child on selling tea and scones. I went back to do what I knew how to do. Right? At the time, Agile was very little known in Australia. The Australian IT culture is, it's a kind of a conservative worldview. It's usually a couple of years behind the cutting edge, at least in the large organizations. And unfortunately, Australia is kind of far away from the rest of the world. So you don't have a lot of professional mobility here. There's Sydney and Melbourne, the two big cities, about 5 million people each. And Sydney is about a 6-hour flight away from any other large city. So there's a limited number of opportunities to do this kind of work in Australia. And that has interesting constraints. But at the time, Agile wasn't anything. And I was the most grizzled and gray agilist in Australia. So I went, well, I can bring that to market. 2005, 2006 was when I started trying to coach Agile in Australia. And I went to a bank called the Commonwealth Bank of Australia. I went in as officially as an application architect, or was it a software architect? I forget what the kind of architect it was, doesn't matter. Solutions architect, maybe. Anyway, but what actually got me in was I went, well, look, yeah, I'll come and do your architecture thing. This was for Cominsure. I said, I'm going to have two anonymized people, Manager X and Manager Y. Manager X is a former or current CEO of the entire banking group these days. Not to put too fine a point on it. So you know why I'm not saying that person's name, because that person, whether they're former or current, is a tremendously powerful individual who can squash me like a bug even now. Manager Y was his right hand back in the day. And so I got hired in, as far as I was concerned, to coach Agile into a couple of teams, a couple of projects inside Cominsure. That wasn't why I actually got hired in. I didn't discover that until about 6 weeks into the gig, when Manager Y took me aside and said, yeah, I really like what you're doing here. This is good. It's proved your effectiveness. And now what we want you to do is go into the global markets group as a spy. And we want you to help us take over that group. Which was a much more prestigious group than the insurance group. And so I did about 6 months of skullduggery while being a solutions architect over there and still coaching these two teams in Cominsure. And eventually bodies needed to be buried and Manager Y pulled the ripcord. And pulling the ripcord meant that he let the guy who owned all of the developers in Cominsure, a very nice man named Des Webster, he let Des through channels know that I'd been coaching Agile, which I thought I had full permission to do, and Des had never heard of. So I had this this email arrive that you will turn up in my office this particular time in this particular place and explain what the hell you've been doing here. And so I spent 3 days carpeted by Des, and at the end of the 3 days, Des, who is a very nice man, Des said, well, you know, there's two problems with this. So the first is, I've got 500 developers and there've been untold numbers of analysts and testers. They all report into to me and we're not ready for this. And the second problem is no one asked me and I can't really let that happen. So that means I can't support you. And I'm really sorry about that. And he walked out of the room and I walked out of the bank. And I never thought I'd work in CBA ever again. I thought my name's Mud. That wasn't the wisest thing in the world. So cutting a long story short, you could have knocked me over with a feather when Des called me up in 2011, 6 years later, and says, well, I think we're ready for you now. But I'm jumping ahead in the story a little bit. So I did say we're doing two case studies, and the first case study actually begins in end of 2009. I had coached I'd done a bunch of kind of agile architect slash program manager stuff with, in particular, a service organization for Reuters called CIRCA, the Securities Industry Research Center Asia Pacific. And that was it was a mission critical program that saved Reuters' ass before they got bought by Thomson's. They were competing with Thomson's at the time. And this was a MiFID compliance piece of work. They thought they were going to buy the solution. They couldn't buy it because Thomson's bought it. And then they had to build this thing 9 months for an E2E trade compliance portal spec to go live. They were a very waterfall, conservative, risk-oriented development organization, Reuters internally. The cherry on it for Circa was they were offering them T+1 data. If you know what that is, it meant you could field automated trading systems, which this is data that's just 24 hours old, straight off the Reuters internal LAN. So that's why they wanted to do this very incredibly risky thing. And to cut another long story short, we got there. Put me in hospital briefly, but we did get there. So very hard yards. And so that led to me doing another job for ThoughtWorks Australia, only job I've ever done for ThoughtWorks. And that led to nothing to do with ThoughtWorks. A couple of guys in IAG heard about some of this work and went, well, this is the guy we need because we have a difficult piece of work. So unnamed names, Dave Carpenter, Bernard Cito, these were two senior managers. They had their own budget so they could actually go and hire me. They were reported into a lady named Val Matthews, who was CIO for the Business and Technology Systems Group in IAG. Val's wonderful, but at the time she'd been badly burnt by a bespoke agile effort to do an online home insurance sales program that ran long and over budget and caused an awful lot of grief and lots of quality problems and so on. And I won't name names when it comes to who was involved there because they were all doing best efforts under very difficult circumstances because this was a very, even by Australian standards, very siloed and conservative and hidebound insurance group. They had two brands that were very well established in the market. In New South Wales, NRMA was the brand. And unfortunately for them, in the modern world, brand loyalty among the millennials is non-existent. So they were getting killed in the market. They were losing massive amounts of business to online smaller insurers who knew how to do the do. IAG at the time, it took them 6 months to get changes to the copy on the front homepage of their website into production. So this was not a very agile business in any sense of the word. And so Bernard and Dave brought me in and said, okay, we can't do any rah-rah agile anything. We can't do a transformation. But what we can do is we can do a proof of concept. We want you to pick a particular team or stream. We'll introduce you to all the progressives that we happen to have any control over. And we want you to prove this works. And then we can get Val to support. And then we can do something larger. And so I spent 2 weeks interviewing people who were ostensibly progressive. And I kept having the same conversation over and over and over. And it went like this. I would go, agile, rah, rah, rah. And the person on the other side of the desk would go, oh, mate, yes, 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 that's what we want. That's great. Only one problem. Those guys over there, guys and gals over there, you'll never get them to do it. And if they don't do it, we can't do it. And I'd say, no worries, no worries. Just tell me who to talk to over there and we'll get it lined up and we'll be sweet. So they'd go, oh, go talk to Dave. Dave's really good. He's I've worked with Dave all the time. Fantastic. Just go talk to Dave. So they'd even line up the calendar for me to talk to Dave. I talk to Dave and I go, agile, rah, rah, rah. And Dave goes, yeah, mate, yeah, yeah. Tom told me you were coming. And I tell you what, that would be fantastic. There's one problem. What's that? Well, you'll never get them to do it if they don't do it. Well, we can't do it. And I'd say, but I just talked to Tom over there and Tom says he wants to do it. And Dave would say, well, yeah, Tom's good, but the rest of them have been there for 25 years, 30 years. They're never going to change. You've got Buckley's, which is to say, if you're not in experience with Australian vernacular, there used to be a department store, Buckley's and none. And so the idea is you've got two chances, Buckley's and none. Anyway, so I had that conversation six times in 1 week, and I went home very depressed. I went, oh, God, this is, I'm on a, again, Australian vernacular, hiding to nothing. We're not going to get anywhere. So I promise I won't put too many Australianisms in this. So anyway, I had an idea, and I came in and I sat Dave and Bernard down, and I said, okay, so I've spoken to all of the people that you told me to speak to and all of the people they told me to speak to. And I can't do what you asked me to do, but I have got an idea about something we can do. And Bernard was very forthright, and Bernard said, well, what's that? And I said, well, what we could do is we could pull all of those people into a single new uncompromised business stream, business, because they're all over the place, business, design, delivery, DevOps. It wasn't called DevOps, but ops. Just a dozen of them, 20 of them. And we can make that work. And Bernard said, yeah, we can't really do that because we don't control those other groups. And I said, well, so I think I know who to talk to get permission to grab some of these people, and they've got problems to solve as well. Now, the way we do this these days doesn't involve that kind of song and dance. There's a much easier way to get people enrolled, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. So there were some lessons to learn. I'm sorry, Richard, you're saying
I'd love to hear these other ways, because as far as I'm concerned, we still have this song and dance a lot of the time.
Yes, we do. And we'll get to that. We call it the Seven Samurai Kanban. So I'll walk you through that after I've done the two case studies. And it's very straightforward, and we've applied this in many organizations, and it just works, which is the beautiful thing about it. Because usually transformations are extremely risky and extremely unsuccessful. And there are waves and waves and waves of these things. And every time a new framework turns up, or a new consultancy with a new framework, which usually is branded with the consultancy's name and based on some standard framework, so they've got deniability. I didn't realize that what I was doing with these two cases was any different to what other people did when it came to transformation. I thought, surely this is the only way to do it. At least I thought that after the conversation we're about to discuss, because it just seemed like, well, how else could you possibly get it to work? And I still think that. So it's a bit dismaying that it's still relatively unknown. But anyway, that's why we're doing this session. So what we'll do is we'll get the progressives, or their right-hand people, because usually I was talking to people who, you know, really had command and control kind of activities as their main thing, but they all had people they trusted to get things done. So we wanted to get them, but we needed a little proof of concept before that. We produced just with people that reported into Dave and Bernard, which was the BTS group had about 330 people in it. So just a tiny little segment of those, the young guns, we made a little team we called the Small Changes Team, because they were only going to be authorized to do small changes. We had a wonderful manager, Kim Pawanto, out of Ops. Kim arranged for us to get access to the hotfix deployment pathway. And we did a whole bunch of BDD, TDD on the front, so that there's actually quality and automated testing going to that pathway, which made everybody on the ops end very happy, because getting tested changes was very different to what they were. I mean, on a regular basis, is different to the kind of crisis management they were used to. We had the testing folk got involved as well to approve the work. And so we had about a dozen people involved in the small changes team. before we broadened the thing out strategically. We had a little strategic squad or scrum or team, whatever you want to call it, but basically people with command and control authority on the front. And then we broadened out the middle stuff. We had a bunch of program managers who kind of did a strategic thing once a week to keep the work on the rails. But the basic thing we did was this. We produced I'd like to call this a steel thread. I'll show you a slide to explain what I mean by steel thread. If I go over here and I'll do like this, I'll better do a share screen just a moment. If I go over here, go back there, and I'll go share screen. I'll do this. Okay. All right. So the basic metaphor here, and this is only a metaphor, but it's sort of, it's a nice metaphor and it gives us a bit of language. This is a diagram of the very first transatlantic cable. And not to go too woo-woo, they had no idea what the shape of the ocean floor was when they laid this cable. So what they did was they had a little boat with a spool of steel thread, and they'd sort of spool this into the water with a weight gauge. So they would know when you no longer had, when the weight stopped increasing as they're spooling the thread in, well, then you knew that the steel thread was on the ocean floor. And they didn't reel that back into that first little boat. They reeled that into a larger boat that had a machine that would wrap more threads around this initial steel thread to make a cable. And then that went into the water, and there was a bigger boat again that had a machine that wrapped cables around that initial cable, and then a really big boat with segments of cables, and then wrapped that and some cladding around. That's how they made the first transatlantic cable, iteratively, because they were dealing with a very unknown domain, a VUCA domain being the ocean floor. So this is sort of the metaphor we want. We wanted to basically have a way to pull the transformation into existence, rather than to try and lay cable all over the ocean floor and pretend that somehow we're going to build a world-spanning internet all at once. That's not a very good model, basically, when you don't know the shape of the ocean floor. It would be a very costly and compromised exercise. Enough metaphors. At least for now, we'll get to Seven Samurai a little bit later. So now, if I go and stop that. Okay. Well, so what we did was we got this initial thing to win, which I intensively coached it to make certain we got the win, but it was only a small group, so it was easy. And that's the whole point. When you're working with progressives and a small group of them, it's easy to get a win. Not rocket science. So what we did then was we went, great, let's split this capability right down the middle. We weren't trying to change any existing teams or streams. We had aligned with the other managers, both line managers and program managers. They knew what was going on. We kept them up to date as we went. But no one was ever asked to change the way that their team was working. What we did instead was we went, okay, well, we'll split this in two, and we will invite people who know these people, who trust them. When they say this worked, they'll believe them. We'll invite them in. So we basically split it in two. And then we had green people who'd never done this kind of working before. We had them join the two little programs and learn how to do things this way. So it took us about 2-3 months for each split. But after 11 months of this, we went from one of these steel threads to 16, which was most of the 330 people. And we did some rah-rah as we went along. We had all kinds of interesting politics in the middle, as you always do. There were some other change initiatives that we had to kind of rope in and get to support. But, you know, at the end of the day, it was about mutual benefit. You'll get your win for your one that was sort of branded to be about climbing a mountain. And they had a bunch of actual mountain climbers in, and we did a day of song and dance around that and so on. But the point was that after 11 months, we actually got there. And I can say we got there because I've got, if you look on my LinkedIn profile, you'll see some references from people who went, yeah, Pete was there at the start of what we did with Agile at IAG, and the early wins were Pete, and those guys are still there. It's fair to say that, that was good. Not only did we get the win for the BTS group, which no longer exists. So if you go looking for BTS and IAG, they've reorged multiple times since then. I think Dave is a CEO for, last I heard, it was a grocery delivery network, and Bernard, I think, is working in New Zealand on something large and financial, but it doesn't matter. And Val is still, last time I saw her anyway, she was still doing a whole bunch of executive consulting and executive roles in Sydney. So it was good for everybody. But the point is that it was culture changing for IAG. I got poached. I got pulled into to CBA, which is the story I'm going to tell next. So I was basically there for about a year, and I had to hand it off to someone. And I'd been doing some work for ThoughtWorks Australia before. So I suggested to Dave and Bernard, you know, might want to have a chat with a couple of guys I know there, which maybe wasn't the wisest thing for me to say, because ThoughtWorks came in and they'd stopped doing full transformation. They just did what ThoughtWorks always does. ThoughtWorks knows how to make its money doing its thing. And I'm not knocking them. ThoughtWorks do, they provide a lot of value, but they don't do full transformation. What they do typically is they'll parachute a whole bunch of very clever young folk, usually with one gray hair, into a joint. The gray hair will wander around talking to people. The young folk will prove value. And then when the rest of the business can't keep up, then they'll pull them out again, and then they'll wait for the business to fall over itself, and then they can come in and solve a problem again. And that's a good model. But it's not culture changing, not organizational change. It's just not what they do. So it turned into what I do. And that's kind of weird. But I'm going to tell the next story to explain, because that was just 330 people. And for a lot of people on this call or listening to this recording, 330 people is a drop in a bucket. So the next gig was CBA again. As I mentioned, Des Webster called me up and said, I think we're ready for you now. And he paired me at the hip with a wonderful man named Kenny Joseph. Kenny was an executive manager under Des. The CBA structure is you've got sort of the group C-suite, and then under them you've got divisions, each of which has their own C-suite. And underneath them you've got executive general managers, then you've got general managers, then you've got executive managers, and Kenny was an executive manager. So Kenny had the ability to navigate and work as peers with people. I was there as strategist and principal coach, and basically if something went wrong, I would get it in the neck and Kenny would try again with somebody else. As it was, we didn't need to do that, but I was there because I'd already done something that had got some parts of the bank to regard me as non, some managers of the bank to regard me as non grata, and manager X and manager Y didn't want me there. And the entire time I was there, they were gunning for me. No problem with that whatsoever. I completely understand why they were. I wasn't, from their point of view, part of the team of people they thought of as team players. It was a political force that we had to deal with throughout the story I'm about to tell, but it wasn't a problem in the sense of it didn't doom us. It just meant there were certain things I could do and certain things I couldn't do. And that's fine. I mean, one person cannot transform a bank of 50,000 people. So a lot of what Kenny and I did to begin with was go, well, who can we bring in to work with us? Kenny had a couple of people who really were excellent already. Elvira Lee, who I think is now Agile Practice Lead for, I think Westpac, but anyway, one of the big banks. And but happily, the work I had done in 2005 in the bank, a lot of the people that I'd worked with then had come up to this executive manager level. So I'd planted some seeds, and here I was 6 years later, able to actually play off some of those connections. And I cannot put hand on heart and tell you that that wasn't useful, and we could have done 50,000 people without having any contacts in the bank, that would have made it a lot harder. The fact that I knew people and they trusted me, that made it a lot easier, but it didn't make it easy. So anyway, I came in off the back of the IAG thing, talking pull transformation and steel threads and so on. And we got a program director in treasury and risk to buy off on this, a gentleman named Chris Young, who is these days one of the stewards in XSCALE Alliance. So I think it's fair to say that Chris liked what happened there. So he had a program called Liquidity, and we used that as our steel thread in treasury and risk. There were two other steel threads. One was in digital channels, a program called Kaching, and another in wealth management that Sarah Atkinson ran, MyWealth. And at one time, all of these reported into the same coaches college, and then manager X and manager Y went, well, we and Sarah will go and take care of wealth management. And Sarah stopped reporting into our coaches college, and no knock to Sarah, she did a brilliant job over there. She started a consultancy off the back of that does a lot of excellent work these days. So I want to be really clear about this, that when you are involved in political things, things can get very fraught and you can go, oh God, they're rat bastards over there. But later on you go, nah, they were doing the same thing I was doing and they were just trying to make a go of it. And the fact that we came to blows, it's not a big deal. So really, I encourage everybody on the call, if you find yourself in things that are fraught, think a little bit more about setting up a bit of a tea house outside of ours, where you and these people who you're at odds with can just get together and go, your win is my win. If we can get a win in this organization, then we're all going to dine out on this for years to come. So let's find a way, even though, yes, we're politically divided, we can't get these executives to see eye to eye, but we can make certain that as we go along, we're aligned and we're going to get good things to happen. That kind of out-of-band conversation can solve a lot of problems, even where in the trenches, yes, you have to shoot at them and they have to shoot at you, and life's like that. So that's, anyway, that's more strategic 101 than it's like the Christmas truce in the First World War. So there was a bit during Christmas where everybody came out of their trenches and shared their drinks and sang carols together at the end of, I think it was 1914. Then the general started shooting people for fraternizing with the enemy. Never mind that. So point is, we had a coaching college of about a dozen players, and really fine people, and if you know any of those folk and they tell different war stories, that's great. They just saw it from a different angle. I'm showing you, talking about what happened as far as I was concerned. The pull transformation strategy was the point. So to tell another war story, I was coaching happily in treasury and risk and working with Kenny to package this up and make this into strategy for the bank as a whole. Des and Tim Whiteley was the EGM above Des. They owned us. So I hope you guys aren't hearing the background noise I'm hearing. I might close these and see if that helps. Okay. Anyway, so when I was splitting my time between whole bank strategic change work and doing a steel thread in treasury and risk, I expected that I'd be doing that steel thread for a year or two at least, that really we wanted to get the big win, that they would really demonstrate to the group, CIO, CEO, that here was value, because we only had political support up to this EGM level, and above that, nothing. So as far as we were concerned, we needed to find something to play off. And so that was part of the attraction, was that we'd be able to get this stuff to spread to thousands of people before we tried to get it to spread to tens of thousands of people. Well, while I was doing this work, I was also training people, progressives in other divisions of the bank. And in particular, there was an experimental program in online, what came to be called digital channels later on, reporting into the general manager, Rob Webb there. And this is a group called Kaching. And they had this idea. There had been an effort to do a person-to-person payments app for across all the banks in Australia for a business called BPay that I'd been involved in coaching for Thoughtworks earlier on. I wasn't Thoughtworks. No, it was a different consultancy. Sorry, I'm telling a lie. Anyway, doesn't matter. That other consultancy shall remain nameless because I'm still cranky with them. Anyway, when we got this stuff to a place in BPay where it was ready to rock and roll, BPay fumbled the ball and CBA picked the ball up. They went, okay, well, we could actually do that program, but we could do it in-house and it'll be enormously influential. But it's also really risky because there were no person-to-person payments apps in the world at the time. And the idea with Kaching, the sort of the marketing idea was, in Australia, we do this weird thing with beer, where we'll go to the pub, and instead of everybody buys their own beer, one person will buy a beer for everybody else in their drinking party. We call it a shout. And so we take turns having shouts. And of course, that means that you get towards the end of the evening and people start leaving and they don't take their turn. And you're kind of out of pocket, the last person who shouts. And so, you know, they owe you $5. So their marketing push was two people sort of there at the end of the evening going, oh, mate, don't worry about it. And they'd clink their phones together and $5 would jump from one phone to the other. And that was sort of, that was the idea. So obviously it became a much larger idea as we went along. Anyway, so I trained two Scrum Masters and their teams over a period of about two and a half days in XP. And then I said, well, would you like me to come do a bit of coaching for you guys? And they went, no. We've got this under control. Your ideas are really excellent. Really love this stuff. This is going to be great. Come and ask us in 3 or 6 months and we'll let you know how it's going. And you do a case study on that. So I thought, okay, good. Well, I'll keep focusing on treasury and risk. And then Kenny calls me up and he says, we've got trouble. And there's a man named Rob Webb who's going to give you a call. And he's a general manager and he owns those guys that you trained. And he's not very happy. Now, Australians have kind of a reserved way of expressing unhappiness. Not very happy is Australian for this guy is going to tear you into little shreds. He's completely furious. He wants to hammer you because a disaster has occurred. We might say things in Australian vernacular, you might say the results are pretty ordinary, and that means a complete schmozzle, a disaster, a cluster F in American terms. Anyway, so I go and meet with Rob and I said, g'day, my name is Pete. I trained these guys on Kaching. He said, g'day, my name's Rob. I'm about to stop doing Agile. How are you? And I said, well, Rob, why are you going to stop doing Agile? And he said, well, I've been talking to these Scrum Masters, and as far as I can tell, it's because it does exactly what you said it was going to do. He said, well, they say that you said that all of the dials are going to turn red, and they've all turned red. And the business is accusing us of under-delivery. And that's another one of these gentle Australian words for a complete disaster. And basically, I've got no choice. I've got to stop unless you can solve the problem that I'm wearing at the moment. He said, and I'm making this a very calm conversation. It was not a very calm conversation. He said, look, predictability is the name of the game when it comes to these sorts of programs. We have to be able, you know, we have lead times on marketing, we have lead times on operations, we have all this production support, all of this stuff. We've got to get lots of people aligned. This is not something like a startup. And you're running this, or they're running this like a startup. And we can't do that. We need predictability. And the business is saying that we've slipped horribly on the first 3 months of this program. And you know, we've got some stuff in production, but it doesn't look anything like the spec. And when I go to the Scrum Masters, they say, oh, everything's great. We delivered maximum ROI. We did exactly what the product owners said we should do. The product owners are some young guys that have nothing to do with the actual business stakeholders for this. They had a couple of meetings with the business stakeholders, and then they just prioritized whatever the heck they wanted to, never mind the spec. We can't have that. This is a disaster. Unless you can give us predictability, this is just never going to fly. And so you tell me how we do that in an Agile program, we'll keep going. And I said, well, Rob, can I have a weekend to think about it? And he said, yeah, you'll be here in this conference room, 6:30 Monday morning, because that's when I get in, and you tell me how this works. And I went, okay. And I went away, and I came in at 6:30 with three slides and a lot of hand waving. And Rob went, Rob used to be a developer, so he's got a really good systems head. Don't want to take anything away from Rob at all. Rob's fantastic. And he goes, all right, I can see how that could work. So yeah, that would give us predictability. Where else in the bank are we doing this? I said, nowhere, Rob. He said, well, okay, where else in the banking industry is this being done? Nowhere, Rob. Well, where have you seen this before? Rob, I came up with this in the bath yesterday. He said, you want me to bet my career on something you came up with in the bath yesterday? I said, I don't know how else to do it, Rob. He said, well, I won't do that. I said, well, I don't know what to tell you. He said, I have an idea. He said, I won't bet my career, but I'll bet your career on this. If you'll put hand on heart and tell me you think this is going to work, then I'll let you have 3 months to make this work. And if it doesn't work, I am going to blacken your name, not just in the bank. And maybe that's not a politically correct term. I'm going to destroy your reputation. Let's say that. Not just in the bank, but all banks all around the world, everywhere I can possibly reach. I'm going to destroy you if this doesn't work. Are you still willing to do it? And I said, yeah, Rob, I reckon it's going to work. He said, I think it's going to work too. I'm going to support you to the hilt for the next 3 months. So Rob does know how to make certain he gets people to do the work. So anyway, after 3 months, if you want to know what that stuff was, this was about breadth first product agility, product management. It's really the meat and potatoes of what we call XSCALE these days. And I'm doing a session on how we do that breadth first product agility stuff. You can find lots of stuff in my LinkedIn profile on how we go about doing that. But I will talk about it a little bit when we get to the sort of hands-on, because we do exactly the same stuff when it comes to transformation with a twist, because we think of learning as the product. And when you start thinking that way, well, we want to do that breadth first as well. So I will reveal, there's nothing hidden in what I'm talking about. It's just that we only have a certain amount of time in this session. So anyway, we got things winning there. And when I say winning, that program, after 6 months, had 500,000 or 300,000 or 400,000 actual active users, daily users. And it won at the end of that year the Group CIO Award for Best Program in the Bank, because it went green across the board and stayed there in the program services planning, the big steering committee for the whole bank. It was the only program that had ever done that and stayed green across the board, delivering on time and to the penny on budget throughout. And if you're interested in how on earth you can do that, well, you do have to make certain that the reporting systems serve your purposes, but we'll talk about that in the other session. So, but it also won dozens of external awards. By 2 years later, the Australian Financial Review published a study that valued the digital channel we created at $9 billion. And so this became the motivating force for Agile in the bank, the steel thread. And then, so Sarah got a nice win in wealth, and then I'd handed the liquidity program off to a coach named wonderful man, Dave Bales. So Dave got that to land. Chris Young was out of it by then, so it was a different program director. Chris went to Switzerland, became head of the Swiss Agile Association, and he introduced a bunch of this stuff to HSBC in 2015. That got XSCALE to be one of the 12 frameworks in the Gartner market guide to enterprise agile frameworks in that year, and it's been in there for the last 5 years. So that was all thanks to Chris's efforts. So this stuff has kicked on, which is lovely. Lejana, are you wanting to put your oar in the water? Because you were there for some of this. Maybe not.
Oh, sorry. I will say what I can. I have got kids running around the house, so it might be a bit noisy. At the time, I think I was sort of starting to get involved in a lean transformation, which was kind of running in parallel. So I think that's when we started to kind of head down the path of Agile at the kind of tail end of that. I think for me personally, that was really transformative. And at the end of that, I think that's when I realized, excuse me, the kind of the value of Agile at the tail end of that. But that 12 months of kind of going through the lean process was really personally transformative.
Yes.
I didn't feel that at the time, but certainly at the end, and obviously years since then, I can really see the benefit of that.
Yeah, hindsight's always 2020. And obviously the bank went through waves of transformation after the period we're talking about. But I should also give credit where credit's due, because that lean transformation was enormously valuable to what we were doing with Agile. It gave us channels to work through. So this is a pattern that we like to talk about in XSCALE as a T-shaped transformation, where the idea is you do something that has broad influence to sort of fertilize the ground. And so the lean transformation that Lejana and I did some work on together was about something we were calling the four productivity practices. You remember that?
Yes, and the new way of working, yes.
Yes. So for people who are more agile oriented, the four productivity practices were, you correct me if I'm wrong, let's see. There was visual management boards, which was three-column Kanban by another name. What were the other ones?
It was called the daily stand-up at the time.
Yeah.
And then we had continuous improvement.
Yeah, which was retros. And standard operating procedures.
I can't.
Basically definitions.
That's right. Exactly, yeah. Right.
but the beauty from the Agile perspective, the Agile program perspective, was that suddenly the old guard managers, the frozen middle, when they looked around this big, open, active working floor, they couldn't tell the difference between the artifacts of the Agile programs and all the other programs that had gone on this shallow but effective transformation, lean transformation. So it meant that we could... I think Dave Bales and I trained about 1,800 people across various divisions of the bank in the four ways of working. But at the same time, we were taking them through an XP simulation as part of this, what I used to call the extreme hour. So that's not to say that there weren't still plenty of problems. And so getting back to Kaching, once we had got some really big wins, and we have some people who have had careers based on those wins, Nick Ho, Leandro Pinta, who are very well-known and successful practice leads and coaches around the Australian traps, they were my two Scrum Masters back then in Kaching. The way that this kicked on had its own lumps and bumps. And in particular, there was a point where Alex Koch, who was the executive manager who owned Kaching, Alex had scheduled holiday time for all of the, by then, three Scrum Masters, because Leon Trant has stepped up, and Leon's a brilliant Agile coach and also part of XSCALE Alliance. He'd scheduled holiday time for all three at the same time, which wasn't going to be a big deal. I mean, no one thought it was going to be a big deal, but it was happening during a very politically fraught time. And so I made a decision that was, with the benefit of hindsight, bloody stupid. I said, oh, don't worry about it. I can easily go and Scrum Master their teams for a couple of weeks, and then they'll come back and not a big deal. A Scrum Master is not a coach. A Scrum Master has to defend the work their teams are doing. And so this lost me the trust relationships with the business that I'd had working in that program up to that point. Because I just started to be regarded as a partisan. I was Rob's guy making certain the technical side. It was basically two tribes in CBA at the time. Might still be, I don't know, these days. But business and technical, this was a matter of different reporting lines. So the idea that you would go, well, we're going to be cross-functional all the way up, that wasn't part of our culture at the time. Might be these days. I haven't stepped into CBA for several years now. So XSCALE Alliance is kind of keeping me jumping. Anyway, when that happened, I wound up handing off to another coach. And Kenny said, look, mate, if you're going to stay involved in this, we have to find a place that's defensible for you to be coaching. And right now we've got Sarah's doing this part and for manager Y, can't go there. We've just done a changing of the guard in digital channels. So yes, you could go there, but you're going to be way disempowered there. Why don't you go and coach the oldest part of the bank, the core banking group? And I can't give you any executive support there. You're going to have to just do your dance and play catch as catch can. But I've seen you do that, so go do that. So I went, okay, no worries. And so that was sort of the last 18 months of my stint. I'm still doing the work with Dave on the sort of horizontal part of the T-shaped transformation. But I went in there and started fishing around for, well, who has problems to solve? And there were plenty of middle managers and executive managers that had problems to solve. But where I really sort of found my main gig was in the data warehouse group. And they had a problem that will be familiar to many people who are used to old style banking groups, where you have layer after layer after layer of component oriented teams, each handing work off to the other. And the people down the end, which is to say the data warehouse group, wind up finding out about things way late, after all of the bodies have been buried and all of the dust has settled around compromises to get programs to market. They might have had the original spec, but they haven't been involved in any of the program steering conversations up until the end. So they are under constant time pressure. And you know, we're talking about people who were working 60 to 80 hour weeks and never saw their families and never had weekends, and it was very sad. So the GM who owned that group pulled me in. I wish I could remember his name. Good guy. Anyway, it'll come to me. Pulled me in and said, okay, if Agile can solve this, then I'm all over it. I'll support anything that fixes this problem. So I had a couple of program managers, Banaz Calapisi, I think is the last name, and a couple of others. And anyway, who had the problem from the other end, because from their point of view, they have these beautiful programs all mapped out. They spent a lot of time, big design up front, getting things mapped out, how they're going to work through all these layers. And then they wind up with this horrible compromise botch being delivered. And it's always blamed on the people at the end that they were the reason, because they went late, because they were under all this time pressure. So I got these two ends in a room and I said, look, we can actually solve this problem by getting these people to attend all of your steering meetings. And we'll make certain that what we do in data warehouse works BDD, TDD, that we'll put the tools in place, and we'll make certain that we have all the acceptance criteria for, this is all style banking, so the actual outcome as far as they're concerned is extracts and reports. So we'll make certain that in terms of sourcing this stuff from the middleware, forget the name of the middleware group, doesn't matter. We'll have all the acceptance criteria written as executable specifications as BDD tests, and then we'll just hand that off to them. And that's just what we did. So basically the beauty of this was, it's a pattern, a change pattern that I started calling the glass onion, because it's transparent from each end as you're looking sort of towards the middle. So the beauty was that all that the data warehouse group had to do was make certain that as the acceptance criteria changed in the program steering groups, that they changed their testing criteria. They weren't actually sourcing real data to deliver, but they were working with test data sets that reflected what they were learning in those meetings. And that meant that all the time pressure they were under moved up to the layer above them. And we had invited that layer to come and do cross-functional teams with the data warehouse guys. They went, no, we're not under time pressure. We're perfectly happy with our world. Thank you very much. Our KPIs are all about doing things that deliver to those guys as customers. We don't have to worry about any of their concerns, and we don't want to. Well, suddenly they were under time pressure and they had to come to the party. So these patterns, the steel thread, the T-shaped transformation, the glass onion, these were the meat and potatoes of getting this pull transformation stuff to work, as far as I was concerned. So at the end of 2013, with all of these programs winning, the Agile Coaching College got invited to go along to a session in the Colonial Mutual Theater, hosted by Michael Hart, who was the group CIO for the entire 50,000 person group. And Kenny had a bunch of meetings with Michael. And Michael, the following year, went off to the bank, big British bank. Jonathan Smart coach for him there. Can't believe
it was Barclays.
Barclays, thank you, Lajana. Yeah. Having got this win there, he was very enthusiastic about supporting, providing group executive support for agile transformation at Barclays. So CBA was basically where the work that Jonathan Smart and Michael did, where that got its grounding. So anyway, Michael held this all hands executive meeting in the Colonial Mutual Theater, where he stood up and said, Agile is now one of the five pillars of this bank's future. And then he had me talk for 10 minutes. And that was mainly because Kenny wasn't there. But as far as I was concerned, yay, this was the big win. Wow. So now I'm set. I can coach forever. That's going to be, my career is made. That's not how coaching works. On the strength of that, I went and got pulled into some programs at Westpac, and then got politically wrong-footed and scapegoated and had no choice but to start this thing called XSCALE Alliance, because, as I said, the Australian market, there is very little professional mobility here. It's not like you can go in America, you can go, oh, well, that was a bit messy, I'm gonna go to the next city over, and yeah, I'll have a long commute for, you know, a few months, and then I'll think, oh, yeah. No, you don't have that kind of mobility here. So I went, okay, what can I do? I've got all this lovely experience, but I don't want to leave Sydney. I've got a bunch of people who are offering me work elsewhere, but this is really where my young family is. And I had stopped running the tea house in the rainforest by this point. I'm going to see if I can help other people do this. And that's where the slides I'm about to show come from. Because basically we've been training Agile coaches in pull transformation for a little over 5 years now, as part of XSCALE Business Agility, which is one of the two offerings in, I'm not trying to sell the thing. If you want to know more about what we do there, we're running some games without thrones, which is about how we get autonomy and alignment to happen, accelerate learning flow across the organization using a combination of quality circles and rotating councils. And there's a whole bunch of really interesting patterns there that are much more sort of meat and potatoes for me these days, that are from the point of view of what we did in CBA. We did some of this stuff in Kaching, but XSCALE is something that I put together when I realized that pull transformation means we don't have to compromise on what we do with our transformation work. We can do things that people think of as extreme. We don't need to say, oh, you can only do Scrum or you can only do Safe. We can actually get full-on end-to-end business agility first to happen because pull transformation. This enables us to do transformation work without disruption, without compromise, to prove it as we go and then grow it at an exponential rate, but at a rate that the organization is capable of adapting to and align the work as we go and work breadth first. And so I want to give you another metaphor to understand that. So I'm going to work you through a set of slides we use as part of the XBA XSCALE Business Agility training material. This is not those slides. This is sort of what we give to executive general managers, to or C-suite folk, to give them an idea of what they're buying. Because often they don't want to buy the whole thing. They might already have a bunch of change staff on staff, and they simply don't want to get an external consultancy or external consultants to do the do. They want us to line it up, which would be sort of, we're going to go in, discover what needs to be done and frame it for them. Maybe they want just that initial steel thread, and that's what we think of as inception. We'll get that working end to end with actual acceleration of business throughput, not just some team's velocity. And so that's what we call inception. Mobilization is where, well, no, they really do want help throughout the change program. They want to grow the thing. And they, as they get various kinds of bottlenecks, they want us to focus on the constraint, the change constraint, and help them through that. And that's a very traditional enterprise coaching kind of an engagement, but it builds on the stuff we're going to talk about for discovery and inception. And then you've kind of got this refactoring idea. This is not refactoring in the sense of improving the design of existing programs, systems, well, programs in a electronic sense, programs in a business sense. Yes, it is, because often we have to do some surgery on the reward models and the reporting and accounting paradigm to get business agility first to happen. So this is not, we start with discovery as a phase and then we do inception as a phase and then we do mobilization as a phase. No, these are activities that are happening in parallel. And this is more a matter of giving a menu to executives that are used to seeing things presented as chevrons so that they can say, well, we want some of this and a bit of that, but none of this. And you know, we want to make certain that what we're selling is what they're buying. And so this is our menu for them to pick and choose from. we're going to come back to this because what we actually do has to map onto this. So that brings me to the seven samurai. Now, there's some homework for this session. If you have never seen the movie, The Seven Samurai, it was a movie that was written during the American occupation of Japan and then produced in the 2 years after the American occupation of Japan by a man named Akira Kurosawa. It is the very first action film in the world. And at the first hour or so of a 3 hour, 7 minute movie, you might go, where's the action? But there is, it's a really riveting film and amazing, but this is the best film for learning how to do enterprise agile coaching ever made. It's brilliant. Everything that you do as a coach at an enterprise level is in this movie. So I'm going to set the scene and use this as a metaphor to sort of guide you through this. So the movie starts with these 40 bandits. This is the Sengoku period in Japan, or the end of it, when peace had descended on Japan, which is to say there were a whole bunch of out-of-work samurai, and a bunch of them became bandits, and they're terrorizing villages. And so that's it. So it starts with these guys looking around this village, and the nastiest of them goes, ha, 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 let's go right down there and we'll do all these terrible things. And one of them says, boss?
Yeah?
We were here 3 months ago.
Oh, they won't have regrown their crops. We'll go and raid another village and then we'll come back.
Not the fiercest thing you ever heard a villain say in a movie, but that's what they do. What they don't know is that just over the other side of the hill, there's an old woodcutter who hears what they say. And I'm sorry if I'm spoiling the movie. I'm not really spoiling the movie. There's so much in this movie. It's so rich. I can't spoil it. But if you haven't seen it, you might want to, if you listen to the recording, pause the recording, go watch the movie, come back. Anyway, they hold the world's most miserable open space in history. The theme of this open space is what's the least painful way for us to kill ourselves? Because we're all going to die horribly anyway. Apart from the things the bandits are going to do to us, we're all going to starve to death afterwards. We have hardly any grain left from the last time they were here. And and no one's going to help us. We can't go to the local magistrates. They just, whenever they come in, they just take things from us and leave. There's no one's going to help us. So we're screwed, if you'll pardon my French. And one of them, one young guy who says, I got an idea. Why don't we hire some samurai to defend us? And they all tell him he's an idiot because they can't afford samurai. They've got a couple of bags of rice. That's their fortune in the world. So they go off and talk to the old man of the village who, there's a lot of running in the movie because they don't have horses or cars or anything. So they run everywhere and they run across to the mill on the other side of the creek and they talk to the old man and he's listening to all the things they're proposing to do. And the young guy says, oh, we could hire some samurai. And they're saying, shut up, don't waste his time. He's the wise old man. And says, so what do you think we should do? And the wise old man says, I think we should hire some samurai. And they go, but we don't have anything. We've got some rice. And the old man says, you have to hire some hungry samurai. So they wind up with this scruffy bunch. And so if we think about the Coaches College in CBA, I think Lajana would agree that we looked a lot like this. We were a scruffy bunch where the lean transformation program, which was less ambitious and more politically wise than we were, they were much more erudite. They looked much less scruffy. But we worked together. And that's important, as we were talking about, when it comes to having a bit of a tea house offsite. You really want to make certain that if there are other change programs, other change agents, even if they're not politically aligned with you, out of hours, go and do the spade work and make certain you do align. But I'm going to talk from the point of view of the scruffy bunch. And you'll see we've got sort of a proscenium around this picture. And if I'll move this because I think I'm blocking part of it for people on the recording. There we go. Okay. So basically, the way we go about this work starts on the right. You might go, well, why are we starting over here rather than over here? well, obviously, if it's a Kanban, we're going to have a Seven Samurai Kanban, we want to pull the work to the right. We want to minimize work in progress. So that's why we're going to start on the right. And the other way to think about this is that we have value flow moving left to right, but learning flow moving right to left. And so that's why you've sort of got this little archy bit here. We sort of have learning feedback is flowing in this direction. So to begin with, what we typically do these days is we hold an open space. We don't make it the most miserable open space in the world, but sometimes it works out that way, because what we usually do to theme this open space is we say, well, we're not going to have an open space that's about agile anything. We won't use the word agile. And the change agents aren't going to present at this open space at all. We're going to facilitate. And the theme of the open space, we'll use, you know, the three laws, whoever comes along as the right people and whatever is said is the right stuff, and the law of 2 feet. If you're not giving or getting value, then walk along to another session. And we do all of the stuff where we frame this. And if you don't know what open space is, you can go and find lots of material on open space online.
Sorry.
What we typically do is we go to, sorry, someone's trying to say something?
Yes, Peter, you said there is two flows, one from the right to the left and one the opposite side. The learning flow is from the left to the right on this canvas?
No, learning flow is from the right to the left, and value flow is from the left to the right.
All right, from open space to change. Okay.
Yeah.
That's the learning.
Yes, exactly. So, and I'll explain that in a bit more depth, but I should explain a little bit about how we're framing or how we get this engaged anyway. So your change sponsor, whoever they are, they've got some budget or they wouldn't have been able to hire you. So, and they typically have some lieutenants they trust. And these lieutenants then have connections to the rest of the organization. And usually these lieutenants have their own political agendas, and they are not the people you want to work with, but they're the only people you've been introduced to, and the change sponsor trusts them. So it's like you've been introduced to some bandits. Not knocking any of the change sponsors or the lieutenants I've ever worked with. They're all very good people and they all did wonderful work with me, but that's not where they start. So what they start with is, okay, we've been told by someone that we are going to do a change program, and so we're going to make this change program work, even though we've got plenty of other things to do. So they're not the people that you want to work with because they don't trust you, which means you can't trust them. You make a wonderful scapegoat for anything that goes wrong, and they will certainly use you that way, and you know that, and they know that. But even worse, neither the change sponsor nor the lieutenants understand the real change bottlenecks, or really who has to change, or even the real outcomes that a good change would have. They usually have a vision in their head of what they think would be a good improvement, but it's usually piecemeal. It's about, oh, if we could just get to market faster, or if we could just get the specs to be better, or if our testing was better. They have these little bits that they want you to do, and they will prioritize those. So you have to give them a different vision of what this program is going to be. But you can't tell them that, because they want you to provide to, you know, they've engaged you to do a particular piece of work. That's what they want. So a bit of, when we say inception, we do mean this like the movie Inception. We actually have to change what they want, and it has to be their idea. So that's what we're doing here. It's not a matter of being crafty or secretive. It's just a matter of, we want them to get a huge win. We want them to get a win far bigger than the one they want. So we have to actually get them to want that win, and we have to make it easy for them. So that's kind of what we're about with this first part of the pull transformation. And yeah, you can do smaller things, and there's nothing wrong with doing smaller things, but the beauty of approaching it from a strategic, from a point of view of one of these wise old samurai, or the wise old samurai, there's only one of them in the movie, you want to get the win that is going to establish peace across the entire organization. You don't want to just do, you know, like the villagers said, we want you to kill the bandits. You don't want to kill the bandits. You do want to kill the bandits, at least as far as making peace with them is concerned. But you want to get the big win. You want, we'll see what the big win looks like for the village toward the end of this. Or if you've seen the movie, you know what the big win is. Anyway, so, but that's way in the future. Right now, what we're going to do is we're going to say to each of these, the change sponsor and their lieutenants, okay, we want to hold an open space. We want you to write down a list of, depending on the number of the size of the program that we've been asked to coach. We want to have an open space of between 50 and 200 people, something like that. So we'll ask them for a list of either 5 or 20 people that they think are going to be important for the change, not necessarily involved in the change and not necessarily supporting the change, but they will be affected by the change. So give us these lists. So we get these lists. We basically do some refactoring until we've got about the right number of people. We invite them to an open space. The theme of the open space is, how do we make this organization the very best of its kind in the world? What will we have to do to make this organization the best of its kind in the world? No one cannot come along to a program, so to an open space with that theme, because if they don't come along, they'll be seen as the people who are resisting becoming the best. And so it's politically insupportable to not come along. A lot of them will come along going, I have to sabotage this open space. I don't want this change and I don't want my world to change. And I certainly don't want the things that I've got that are going good to be sacrificed for some pie in the sky that's never going to happen anyway. So they'll come along with various kinds of agendas. You don't need to do anything about those agendas whatsoever. As far as you're concerned, you're just facilitating. And you do the usual open space shtick where you get them to write things down on cards, you stick them in a marketplace of ideas, you get them to give 20 seconds about each of these ideas, and you get them to do some scheduling. And if you don't know how to do that, then go and read up about open space technology. Go talk to Dan Mezick. It's really not hard to do. And it's beautiful because it's a wonderful way to influence a culture, which is what we're doing here in a small, blame-free, psychologically safe space. So you wind up with, if you've got, let's say, 6 breakout areas and 3 hours, 20-minute sessions, that's about 54 different sessions on whatever people want to talk about. That's going to be how we're going to generate the best organization of this kind in the world. So it's very blame-free, lots of rah-rah. You can provide a bit of booze if you like, certainly provide tea. Tea is a wonderful social drug. I would rather do this with tea than with booze. And if you don't know how to make good tea, then talk to me after. So anyway, and there's a reason why tea was involved in the end of the Sengoku period, the Warring States period. And if you don't understand that, then I've got an article for you to read on the samurai and the tea master on LinkedIn. And that will explain that part of it. But I'm not going to go into that depth now. So this open space, what typically happens is, well, from your point of view, you get 2 enormous wins without doing anything. And I really like the idea that you get wins without doing anything. So the first win is you see the people you need to work with, the progressives, the people who want change. They light up like light bulbs at this open space. They give the talks, they support, they ask interesting, hard questions. Their positive affect just shines. And some of them will be ops, and some of them will be developers, and some of them will be testers, and some will be analysts, and some of them will be people you have not been introduced to and you don't know exist, or you don't know prior to this. Some of them will be business. Some of them will be executives. Some of the managers, the middle is not frozen completely. It's frozen with some warm bodies trapped in the ice. And you want to find those warm bodies. So they all speak and you can hear them. That's one win. Second win is they take notes. Everybody takes notes. And those notes talk about 4 things you need to know for your strategy group that your change sponsor needs to hear. And this is also beautiful. The change sponsor is there and goes, I didn't know
you've
that.
Gone on to mute, Peter. We can't hear you.
Oh, bugger. How did I go on to mute? Let me see. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you again now. Yep. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. That's my internet connection was unstable. Okay. So I don't know how.
So you were saying that there's 4 things you need to know that they've written down.
Okay, then we didn't miss much. All right, thank you, Richard, for picking me up. So the 4 things. Well, they're kind of impact mapping. They'll tell you why things are screwed up, which is to say, why things need to change. They'll tell you who needs to change. Who's stopping this from being the best organization in the world? Usually it's people who aren't in that room, but sometimes it's people who are in the room and they'll have fights and you have to provide psychological safety and go, no, 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 look, fellas, we're going to work this stuff out. It's not your problem, not his problem. This is the easy problem to fix. As someone who's coaching a pull transformation, you are going to make things easy for them to fix. So you're not telling them lies. They don't believe it, but nevertheless, you can say that hand on heart. So anyway, remember, pull transformation is different to push. We're not pushing change onto anyone. That's part of what makes things easy. We're going to make a resistance-free thread and a superconductor for change, and then we're going to grow it. We'll come back to the growing in just a minute. So anyway, so who has to change? Why? Who? How? People will come up with all kinds of, if they would just do this, then we could do that. And so there was changes in behavior for particular stakeholders. And then what do we need to do to cause those changes? We can't change that way because we would need the following things. Wonderful. Now, of course, these things are not expressed in an orderly way. You get a whole bunch of rough notes and the change sponsor, the tenants, the change agents, you all heard things. Lots of different things are heard at an open space, but you've got a lot of them. You heard a lot of them and you've got these notes, which has a lot as well. So you basically make these people into your initial little strategic squad, your change sponsor and your change lieutenants and your change leaders. I'm going to call them change leaders rather than change agents, because I hate the language around change agents and change recipients. What I want is change participants and change leaders, because what we're going to do in a pull transformation is iteratively convert change participants into change leaders. And we'll come to that in just a moment too. So, and again, different to push, because we don't have to worry about certifying anyone as a change agent or a coach or a scrum master or whatever special words you like to use, release train engineers, or that's all nonsense anyway. The fact is we're working with people. We want Muhin Shu, not Shu Hari. We want to share learnings. And that was how Sengoku was fixed. That's how we're going to deal with our big siloed, hidebound organization. I promise you, no matter how vile and difficult the culture of the organization you are coaching, it is not as vile and difficult as hundreds of independent warlords fighting pitched battles with horses and spears for 200 years across Japan. I promise you it's not as bad as that. And a change in the way tea was served fixed that. Well, a change in the way tea is served in the sense of learning can fix things here. Muhin Shu is the order of the day. We'll explain what that means in more depth as we go along. So anyway, we heard all this wonderful stuff at the open space. We raised awareness about what needs to be done, why, who, how, all of that stuff. We basically have heard what we need to construct what in XSCALE we call an epic landscape. An epic in XSCALE is a normalized thing. It's got a why, a who, a how, and a what. That's the normal form for an epic, which is to say, it's not just things you can finish. It's a generator of things you need to do, and there will be diminishing returns, and you have to worry about using a breadth first view of, in this case, learning throughput to be able to identify bottlenecks and focus on those. We'll come to prioritization as we go. So anyway, what we want to do is we want to make a pirate canvas out of these rough notes we had from the open space. Now, for those who don't know what a pirate canvas is, there's an article on LinkedIn about pirate canvas. We call it a pirate canvas because it's basically a combination of, let's see if I can pull one up. If I go here, there we go. This is a pirate canvas about a food distribution startup that Daniel Hernandez is an XSCALE coach. Put together as part of his XSCALE product agility training, and has allowed me to use as an example. He's got a startup around basically a shopping app that shortens the distance between consumers and producers. Because if you think about it, supermarkets and food wholesalers are just middlemen. And so being able to improve people's access to the quality of food is Daniel's game. Anyway, to give you an idea, we basically have the pirate metrics across the top. And if we think about these in learning terms rather than the terms that are on this canvas, acquisition is acquiring people into our change program, acquiring learners. Activation is the training and coaching we're going to do to get them to become activated. And often that doesn't mean training in the sense that you're thinking. It means we're going to embed them in, when we split one of these steel threads in two, we're going to embed them in one of these, and they will learn by doing. They'll work with people they know and trust, but we'll come to that. Retention, well, we don't want people to change, and then I think every coach has had this experience, you know, you get a team or a program working just right, and then you come back 6 months later and they're back to doing things waterfall. Why? Well, there was a change of manager. Or, we weren't able to get the testers to do what we wanted them to do. Well, there's a lot of different reasons for it, but they all boil down to one thing. The way that progress in the change program is being measured is not a feedback loop. There's nothing to sustain the change. We want to worry about those feedback loops, and we want end-to-end change throughput in a gold rat sense. So there's lots of ways to meter change throughput in terms of business outcomes. We can think of the second derivative of business throughput is change or learning throughput. And if you're interested in why I say that, then that's another session. But I want to sort of, this is a practically focused session. We don't want to talk in abstraction, so we're going to keep things simple. So retention is about how do we retain the change behaviors. Referral is this business of converting change participants into change leaders. And return, well, this is the kinds of change that are enabled by what we're doing now. So when I talked about we built on Lajana's lean program, well, that's the kind of return we want out of the learning we're inducing in the organization. So then here, so that's what we've got across the top. Every one of these columns winds up being an epic, and we can have multiple epics in each of those categories. And then we've got a why, a who, a how, and a what. And then what we do is we do five whys on that first why and work backwards. That's basically how we do a pirate canvas. These things are enormously useful for questioning the frame of a delivery or a change program. And because really what we want to do is we want to grow an ecosystem. If it's a delivery program, we want to grow a business ecosystem or a market ecosystem. If it's a change program, we are trying to build a learning ecosystem, which is what we define as Mu Hin Shu, building learning ecosystems. I'm not going to go into any more depth on Pirate Campus. I want to get back to where we were. Okay, any questions before I go on? Okay, you're either asleep or everybody is happy.
We're doing fine, thanks you, Peter.
No worries, Richard. This is a bit of a fire hose. Usually this is stuff that takes a longer time when we do it as part of the XBA course, but that's okay. I'm not trying to sell that course. We actually are doing a bunch of micro courses, and this is one of them, or at least Kumar Data Tran and Jeltorga Thompson are doing a recorded micro course around Pirate Canvas. I think they're going to charge like $50 for it or something like that. So if you're interested in knowing how to build a Pirate Canvas, then yay. But there's much more to XSCALE product agility than that. It's just sort of the front end. Anyway, doesn't matter. For now, the point is we have a change canvas. And that change Pirate Canvas is giving us an epic landscape for the change program. The beautiful thing about this is that now we have a basis for assessing where we need to focus that is far broader than what we had when the change sponsor said, I want you to do the following things and tell me when you're done. And the other thing that we've got is we've been able to assess not just the change participants and cherry pick the progressives from business, design, delivery, DevOps. But we've been able to assess the change agents we're working with as well. The lieutenants and also whoever else they hired as change agents, we can see what kinds of things they are trying to do. And there's a scene in, well, two scenes in the movie where you see the samurai doing exactly that. The first scene is, these are three peasants who came along to town to find some samurai and from that village that we talked about. And so they have a very hard time. The samurai, because of the caste system, the samurai don't even want to talk to them. They all have certificates, you know, and these guys don't have certificates. So no one wants to talk to them. They find this old samurai who they see perform this act of bravery, which I won't discuss because I'm trying to spoil as little of the movie as possible. They follow him back to his inn and they make him a bowl of rice. And they're trying to convince him to come along and help their village. And there are some ruffians at the inn, and one of the ruffians bursts into laughter. He says, Oh, samurai, this is the funniest thing I ever saw. These guys are so poor, they're eating millet, bird seed, so they can make you rice. They can't afford you. This is the funniest thing. And the old samurai turns to the three villagers and says, is this true? And they go, yes, to our shame, this is true. And he says, well, in that case, your hearts are in the right place. I'll do it. And this is the moment where he says he'll do it. So they're very happy. At least, well, obviously they're not all happy, but the young guy in the middle is the guy who wanted to come and hire a samurai. So he's very happy. So that's one kind of assessment. We're assessing who in the organization really wants the change. But another kind of assessment happens immediately after, where there's this young samurai who's been following the old samurai around, and he's got one lieutenant with him, and they have to hire a bunch of samurai, the scruffy guys we looked at before, they have to find them. So basically what he does is he has the young guy stand at the door with a stick. The young guy is not a samurai. He wants to become a samurai, and the old guy doesn't want him to become a samurai. So he makes life hard for him. Anyway, and what the old samurai says, when someone comes through that door, I want you to hit him with a stick. So if the young guy managed to hit them with a stick, then they don't have the skills they need and they won't hire them. If they get angry at the young guy and try to kill him, then their heart isn't in the right place and they won't hire them. If they won't work for rice, well, then they're not really in a situation where they can be hired anyway. But I'd say there is one extra criterion that you see throughout the movie, and that's in the Agile DAO. There's this lovely passage that says that what you're looking for really in an agilist or to become agile is a warm heart, open mind, and coiled spine. We need people who are going to not resist force by pushing against it, but who are going to find ways to work with the force and bring it back to achieve the outcome. They have to be springy. They have to be agile in that sense. So it's basically what they're looking for, and they wind up with the seven scruffy guys. So that kind of assessment happens naturally as we go about building our coaches college. We use this breadth first canvas to give everybody a common frame to work with. Now, that's not to say that we got all the frame the first time. So this loop, this outer loop with awareness and assessment, we basically want to run an open space every 12 weeks. We will usually use this open space to publicize the wins that we've got in the course of the change program, but we'll also use it to find the next group of people to pull in. So the cadence to our pull transformation is typically a 12-week cadence. Now you might go, wait a second, we can't get anything to happen in 12 weeks. If you were talking push, you're exactly right. But if we've got a small committed group of business, design, delivery, DevOps, and they want it, we can get real outcomes in 12 weeks. And that's lovely. We can actually show end-to-end change. That's convincing. People don't go, oh, they showed me some kind of screwy diagram. Doesn't look like my Gantt chart. And they talked about all these funny words, velocity automated testing. I don't know what that stuff's about. Refactoring. Well, you're lucky if you have people who talk about refactoring. Then you're on a good wicket. Anyway, I'm not going to go down the XP path at the moment. But if you're trying to do transformation of technical guys and you're not baking XP into it, you're on a hiding to nothing. No matter how many books you buy that say twice the work in half the time, you'll very rapidly see half the work in twice the time, but that's a different conversation. Not that I'm bitter or anything. Anyway, so we've got this next layer in. So the idea is we literally are framing this next layer in using that epic landscape, that pirate canvas. So what we want is for each of these epics, which is these blue things, we're going to need to get an idea about what are the features we actually need to deliver in that 12-week period? What's achievable? And we need to align people to specifically those outcomes. So these little green boxes represent the features of the change we think we can get to happen in this 12-week period. And we're going to look at each of the epics in our pirate canvas, and we're going to go breadth first on them. I don't want to get everything down to a story level and make some gigantic PI planning wall. No, that's all nonsense. In XP, there is a principle, YAGNI. You aren't gonna need it. You either need it right now or don't worry about it right now. Now that might come as a surprise to you if your vision of XP is Scrum XP from SAFe. Because if you look on the entire scaled Agile site, you will not find YAGNI even once. And I know because I've looked there over multiple years and they still don't have it there because that's not what they do. They do push and we're doing pull. YAGNI is really important to us. So the idea is that every piece of work we do has a maintenance cost, that retention thing. And we want to minimize the retention cost. We want to minimize the cost of change in general. So the beauty of doing things this way is that we are continuously minimizing the cost of change. We are applying YAGNI across the board. That's why we're talking breadth first. So this is this presentation of sort of Kanban within Kanban. We call this a 3D Kanban. The other dimension to this Kanban is the pirate canvas. Well, pirate canvas plus some extra bits and bobs. Don't worry about that for now. Let's just worry about the current presentation. This is workflow and learning flow. The other dimension is value flow. And yeah, we track that too. But for now, it's just this is an easy way to understand it. So the green things, we have to put together some little group of people, some steering or portfolio or whatever you want to call your strategic council. This is the group that we talked about before. This is your change sponsor, the lieutenants, your coaches. If you think of it in lean UX terms, where you would expect you've got business stakeholders, design stakeholders, and technical stakeholders all meeting regularly together, well, the business stakeholder is the change sponsor, their lieutenants, well, they're not really design stakeholders. Maybe the coaches are the design stakeholders, the lieutenants, and also the people who are participating in this first steel thread or the subsequent steel threads. Those are your change participants, the representatives of those guys. Those are your technical stakeholders. They know what the technical constraints on change are. So anyway, that's going to be the people who are in our portfolio council. When it comes to, well, where do you get them from? This is where that Camelot model comes in. We don't want representatives of teams or representatives of programs. What we want is cross-cutting quality circles. And then we'll have rotating representatives of those quality circles visiting our council. And that's the Camelot model. We did a session on that as part of the Agile 20 festival. So you can actually go and listen to the recording on that. And if you want to actually do it in a toy setting, we have some sessions coming up in March, the Games Without Thrones, that XSCALE Alliance are running. And we'll be putting up times for those shortly. These are all free. From our point of view, we run these for pay with paying clients when it comes to people in the community. We've run them or have been running them for 5 years for free. Typically, a game without thrones is about autonomy and alignment rather than command and control for a group of between 60 and 160 people. And you might go, what? How do you get a group of 160 people to organize with no command and control? Come along to Game Without Thrones and you'll find out. And you might go, well, that's ridiculous. And that's fine. You can hold on to that skepticism until you actually do it. And then you'll go, oh shit, that could actually work. I'm not going to try and convince you now. Anyway, we don't need to worry about that for now because we've got this narrow steel thread. We don't have to get that working. Then we're going to grow it. That's enough. So basically what we're doing though is we're not just coming up with the change features. When it comes to behavior mapping, you can also think of feature mapping. There's lots of ways to map features out of epics. Behavior mapping is a really neat, simple way to do it. Builds on work that Al Gerner and I did at Macquarie Bank. That's a different story, but basically you could do CRC if you wanted to. That would work as well too. If everybody was already aligned to the frame. If they're not aligned to the frame, behavior mapping is a really good way to do it. It's a longer conversation where we have to start talking about what do I mean by frame, but for now let's think of frame in terms of what we're looking at here. Each of these frames is within the one above it. So, but that's not all. We don't have to just come up with a prioritized list of features for the next 12 weeks. We also have to align with the people who are not in the change program, the people who are going to stick sticks in the spokes of our bicycle, the people who they're a bit more frozen. It's just not in their interest to come along. We need to identify them. Well, we get them out of the open space, we can see them because people say, well, that person's going to change. And then they'll go, no, I'm not going to change. So we have to make agreements with them. We think of these as treaties. And you can call them working agreements, doesn't matter what you call them, but basically they're all workspace agreements or whatever. But basically we need these agreements to have teeth in them. So what we do with these change treaties is we say, okay, well, we're going to need, let's say the SAP team. Those were the people who were upstream from the data warehouse group that I talked about before. We need the SAP team to do these things for us. And we're going to need one day a week of one of their junior people to do these things for us to get this stuff into production within 12 weeks. And the manager of the SAP group goes, yeah, mate, yeah, we'll do that for you. No worries. And then 3 weeks in, we ask for them to send someone along and the manager says, sends an email saying, well, actually we're under the gun because this program needs us, so we can't support you. Sorry about that, good luck. This change treaty needs to be in the form of an email where this person agreed to it, and we need to add to our end of it, if you don't come through on your agreement, we're gonna have to hire a consultant. You're going to let the consultant work with you and it's gonna cost this much stuff and it's gonna come out of your budget. And they've already, you know, up front, they go, no, we're gonna get Tom, young Tom's gonna work with you. And you'll be fine. I don't know why I keep on picking on Tom. Young Fred is going to work with you and it'll be fine. Well, when young Fred is not available, we need to be able to go to our change sponsor and say, look, Guido, he agreed to this in email and he agreed it would cost this much to replace. And now he can't give us Fred. You need to take this email and go to your manager's manager and get him to go across to Guido's manager, and get him to put the hard word on Guido to give us some money out of the budget to hire the consultant. So the change sponsor tries to do this and comes back and says, well, they're not going to do that, but he's going to put the hard word on Guido. And so Guido suddenly has his manager's manager telling him, you better support this change program. Most of the time that actually works, as long as you can get the change treaty documented and priced. Make sense so far?
Yep.
Okay. And since we're talking about a 12-week horizon, it's not that much money that's involved. It's just they don't want it to come out of their budget. And that's why you have some political force in doing this. And you're playing off the executive support you're getting from your change sponsor. So this is about getting alignment. In the movie, there's this scene where the samurai actually turn up at the village and all the villagers hide from them. We often see this as coaches, that people here, the agile lean coaches, those are the people who come around and fire half your group. So you just have to hide from them, just do your work. So they don't want to engage with us. In the movie, what happens is one of the coaches, and I think of it as the seven coaches, one of the seven samurai, one of the scruffy guys, unbeknownst to the others, used to be a peasant, which of course is forbidden back in feudal Japan, and I'm spoiling the movie slightly. He knows how the village life works. There's a hardwood pole hanging from a rope on one of the huts, and he goes up, grabs a hammer next to it, and bangs on the end of it. This village is so poor they can't afford a bell, but banging on the end of this pole with a hammer makes a ringing sound, and it's the bandit alarm. All the villagers come out with pitchforks to kill the bandits, and then the old man who has already come out says, no, don't kill him. These are our samurai and they're going to help us. So this is basically getting alignment to happen. Then the samurai do this walk around the whole village with a map of the village, looking at what they're going to have to change. And this is also something we're going to need to do in our change program. We have to walk around with the change participants and go, okay, well, what do we need to deliver to enable the change outcomes? So we have to do some architectural features to enable this stuff. So in the movie, they go, well, there's a big open field over there. The bandits are just going to ride through that. So we're going to have to flood that. We'll divert the creek. It'll be all full of mud. They won't be able to ride through it. We're going to have to put a barricade of bamboo spears here and so on. So basically walking around, figuring out what needs to be done to the village to make it defensible. They have an extra agenda in mind, which will come clear in just a minute. And you will too, because what you're trying to set up is to be able to pull the bandits into the village and kill them. Well, the bandits in this case, let's not think of them as managers, let's think of them as problems to solve. You don't want to kill them, you don't want to get them fired. You really don't want to get them fired because that's going to make people afraid of change. What you want is to get them aligned, and you want to get them ideally to become change participants in the next iteration of change or two. Or increment of change, whatever your language is, you can call it a change sprint if you want to, just up to you. So the point of this is that we're trying to look ahead at what we need to do to enable this change to succeed. Where are the bottlenecks? And of those bottlenecks, which is the constraint? If we focus that way, then as coaches, we're going to be vastly more effective than if we just go, well, I'm going to go talk to these guys, and I'll talk to those guys, and Fred, you go talk to those guys, and we'll get together and we'll compare notes. No, we're trying to work breadth first, and we're trying to use throughput accounting to its best advantage. And we can actually put numbers on things. So the cost of change, the value of change, these are things that if we can put actual dollar numbers on these things, then we can not just control them, but we can quantify our wins and we can graph them over time. We can do a throughput diagram. If you don't know what one of those is, again, it's an XBA concept where it looks a lot like what do you call them? There's multi-layer, it's killing me now.
CFD.
Yeah, one of those cumulative flow diagrams, except that we also have the return stuff graphed on there and we normalize it all to dollars. So that's kind of not really, you know, adding up stories, it's more, or how many stories we have, it's more a matter of outcomes. So the throughput diagrams are really neat and simple things. You can do them in Excel. And I'm not going to worry about showing you those now because we could go on about geeky things all day. All right. So the awareness and assessment stuff, that's kind of when we were talking about discovery, those are the activities there. Alignment and architecture, those are the activities of inception. If we are going to do mobilization, then we have some extra stuff we need to do. To begin with, I talked about measuring the outcomes. Well, in the movie, they also measure outcomes. There's only one way they represent them, and that's this piece of paper where every circle represents a bandit. And when they kill a bandit, they do an X through the bandit's identifier. And so if you think about it, this is they're pulling the work of killing the bandits. This is literally can bandit. And I'm sorry about the pun, but it's just too rich. And they literally do this. I mean, after they've set the village up so that it's defended, then they open the front gates, let some bandits in, and keep the rest out. And they kill those bandits, and they open up and let some more in. They're literally pulling the bandits into the village and killing them, minimizing the work in progress. And that's not too surprising, because this is a movie that was made before Taichi Ono wrote down the details of the Toyota production system. This movie inspired the Toyota production system. Lean is based on the Seven Samurai. So it's not too surprising. At a delivery level, well, we need to understand what change features and what delivery features we need to get done in this 12-week increment. Now, the beauty of features rather than stories is that, well, firstly, we are going to release these. They'll actually go into production, which is to say, if they're change features, we're actually doing these things. The delivery features, they'll literally go into production if we do things using CI/CD, all that continuous stuff. And we should make that a prioritized part of what we're doing if our business is software. But you can do this if you're transforming a hamburger joint, and we have done, because we have some people involved in XSCALE Alliance who are in the food industry, in particular, Darswell Rogers. His son has a chain of restaurants, and you bet he's applying XSCALE stuff, including this, to that, and open book management and all the other stuff we do in XSCALE. So the point of this is, these are general ways of working. Pull transformation isn't about XSCALE. Pull transformation is, this is a set of patterns that's good no matter what kinds of branding you've got and what you're doing. As far as we're concerned, agnosticism is fundamental to what we do in XSCALE, even though, yeah, we've got a name for what we do because there are some values and principles and so on. But the whole point of this is, we love the idea of being the Linux of the agile world. We want all this stuff to be open. We share this stuff. We don't have any special sauce. We only have mayonnaise. So as far as I'm concerned, I want you guys to look at this not as, is he trying to get his brand to be better? No, I don't give a damn about the brand. I do want to get these ideas into the culture. And so a lot of the work that we are doing is more about forging connections. So we work with Gender Shift, we work with Tameflow, we work with all of the little organizations, the little groups, and we're trying, that's why we've been so prominent in the festival, that's why XSCALE Alliance is a patron of the festival. We think Muhinshu should be the way the entire culture works. And if it works that effectively, yeah, Shuhari is still a pattern, but Shuhari should not be a business. Shuhari was invented by a guy named Fuhaku about 200 years after the Sengoku period, after the dawn of tea, as a way to shut out all of the independent tea schools. Well, screw that. Muhinshu is how we're going to get them back. Now, the idea with this loop, we want analytics. We need to have a council of our delivery stakeholders, whether it's hamburgers or software, who are getting together on a regular basis to try and understand where what the throughput is, where the bottlenecks are, how the constraint is moving around to optimize business throughput. So if we think of a business stream, that's our business stream council. If we're using a Camelot style structure, then basically we have every council meeting has some permanent council members, but also rotating members out of each of the quality circles. And the beauty of this is that everybody gets to meet face to face with everybody. And we have a rotation schemes for making certain everybody gets a turn, and we stagger these so that the council always has half its members were on the last council and half weren't. So that way the council itself has a memory of why things were done. Nothing has to be written down except what needs to be reported. And so the beauty of doing things this way is that all of the decisions that are made are used to reprioritize our list of features as we go. So we're continuously reprioritizing. This is 3D Kanban 101. We don't want to say, oh, well, 3 months ago we made some priority decisions and now we've delivered those features. No, If we deliver a feature and it makes the constraint move, then we have to reprioritize. Otherwise, we are wasting the potential for ROI. And that's as true for change as it is for delivery. So continuous reprioritization is the main output of this stream council. Its other output is to try and understand what sorts of treaties might need to be established that we didn't know needed to be established before. So some of that's been given to the portfolio council to try and enable this to work. Everybody okay so far?
Yes.
Beautiful. Now there's one extra part of mobilization, and this is kind of why we're there as coaches. We know how to get things done. So in the movie, you'll see that while the samurai do an awful lot of training and coaching of the villagers, they can't possibly, seven samurai cannot kill 40 bandits. When the bandits have better weapons, they have rifles, they have horses, they have bows and arrows, and the samurai don't. What's more, the villagers aren't allowed to touch a sword or a rifle or a bow and arrow, because with the caste system in Japan at that time, it was death for a peasant to touch one of those things, much less use it. The only weapons that a peasant could had access to was a bamboo pole, and they could sharpen the end of the bamboo pole. And you might go, well, a peasant with a bamboo pole is no match for a samurai on a horse with a sword, and a spear, and a bow and arrow, and a rifle. And that's true. But if you pull a samurai into the village and he's surrounded by 50 peasants with bamboo poles sharpened on one end, you have a better weapon. So basically the samurai use the whole village as the weapon. And that's why they're pulling the bandits in. So nevertheless, they have no rifles and the bandits do. So the samurai, one of the samurai goes and steals some rifles from the bandits. So there's work that you as a coach, you just have to go and do and hand it off to the change participants as soon as you possibly can. So if you have to go and put together some JIRA configuration, hand it off. If you have to go and put together some BDD, some CI kit, you do that, you show them how it works. You train people to do it, you hand it off. You can't let yourself get bogged down. I talked about where I got roped into being a scrum master, for God's sake. Hand that stuff off as quickly as you possibly can, because what you're trying to do is convert the people in this steel thread into change leaders. So you need them to have the skills. The more they are dependent on you to do anything, the less you are actually achieving the outcomes you've been hired to achieve. So the lovely thing about this is that you can just focus on where do we need to accelerate throughput? Where do we have the constraint at the moment? And since you are building up people who are doing this work for you, you have much less to do. And again, what you really want is to not have to do anything. And that's the beauty of pull, is that if you do this right, you are very rapidly working yourself out of a job. Where in a push transformation, you might have steady work for 2 or 3 years. With pull, you might have steady work for 2 or 3 change increments. So we're talking, if a change increment is 3 months, then maybe 6 or 9 months. And you might go, oh my God, I can't afford to do this. I'm going to work myself out of a job. And then my name, you know, I mean, maybe I have a good reputation with these people, but what's going to happen? Well, what's going to happen is what's happened to everybody who's tried this. You're going to get a really good name as someone who actually achieves the outcome, both within the organization that you are coaching. So you'll get work in other parts of the organization. I talked about how that happened to me in First Treasury and Risk Digital Channels Core. You will have mobility, so you won't be bogged down in one part of the organization and the rest just stays the same. So that's beautiful. But even more important, you'll have mobility in your industry, because the people who you're working for, the change sponsor and the other middle managers, they will all say, hey, we got it working. And they'll say this to people in other organizations who are used to saying to them, oh my God, another agile transformation, another scaling your transformation. Oh, the horror, BCG. No, I didn't say BCG. anyway, I don't know what that stands for. Big conglomerated group, probably something like that. Anyway, the point is, we are not here to put our noses in the trough. We are here to achieve the outcome that we're being paid to achieve. So we get to have integrity. That's so much fun. Having integrity as a coach is just the best thing. And when you have a whole group of coaches who have integrity and who are doing this work together, that's where Muhinshu really shines. So it is so much more fun than being a cog in the corporate machine that you might go, well, this is an awfully brave thing to do with one's career. Yes, it is. Courage is one of the Agile values, one of the original XP values. It's a Scrum value if you're fond of that particular cult. The beauty of it is it's recognized. It generates flexibility. So enough rah-rah on that. If you go, no, this is too dangerous, okay, that's fine. You don't have to do this. You can stick with the push transformations right up until we pull transformation people, eat your lunch. I suggest you get on the good foot. Anyway, so that's the mobilization part. Then we've got this refactoring part. Well, to tell the truth, I think I actually have it in the wrong order. I think the analytics and acceleration is the refactoring part. And the inner thing I'm about to do is the mobilization part. It's only a model. It's just like in the Camelot model. It's just a model. So the next part of this is there's some bits in the movie where the samurai they get paid in rice. And they get some local honey and they make rice cakes and they give these cakes out to the kids and they're making funny faces. The kids of the village are all laughing. And it's not really explained in the movie why they would take time out to do this. But my theory is that while the kids can't do the fighting, they are competent enough to sharpen the bamboo poles to make the spears for the adults to use. So I think they're trying to enroll them into their change program. That's what you want to do. So the people who are ancillary to this, you want to build bridges. You want to get them involved one way or another. If you can, in a Muhinshu sense, if you can provide a way to give them a win, then they will support you. So for example, the very first XP program I coached back in 98, this was GMAC in Southern California. And we were having a lot of trouble getting support. Until some of the database architects turned up to a steering group meeting and they said, okay, who is generating these automated tests? And I and Luke Tagaris, I was working with at the time, we were having a great deal of difficulty getting developers then to support us. And so we kind of built our own automated test framework. This is the very first version of VB unit back in the day. VB5. Even I feel disgusted saying I once worked in VB. I only worked in VB for a little bit of time. Most of it was C++. I'll wrap that up. Anyway, we went, well, okay, it was us. And they said, well, we want more of that. Fantastic. We actually know when things break. So suddenly we had support. For folk who feel like I'm going over time, I promise I'll wrap it up pronto. If I look at... how far over are we? We are about 7 minutes over right now. So mea culpa. I'll try and finish this. So point is this. I go like this. There we go. Point is we're trying to get everybody enrolled. And then what we're really shooting for is this. At the end of the movie, there's this lovely scene where the bandits are all dead, but not only that, I said we're looking for a bigger outcome. The village is now planting its rice. And there's this somewhat sexist scene where all of the ladies of the village are planting the rice and all the men are banging on drums and handing them the rice. And it's very clear that this village is about to propagate and grow. The lady in the foreground here is looking wistfully at the younger samurai it's a doomed romance. It's one of the themes and so on. But the point of this is that we are iteratively converting change participants into change leaders. This is our learning flow backwards here. As we split the threads and then hold our open space and so on, as the learning flows are going from right to left, the whole point here is to let new people, green people, come into the change program as quickly as we can demonstrate outcomes. We never push change into any existing teams and streams. Every time we have one of these open spaces, the change sponsors have got sufficient demonstration that they're ready to grow to get the next tranche of funding for the next part of the change program. So we're able to grow our change program as we go and at an exponential rate. And so the beauty of all of this is that we are able to generate change without disruption or compromise. And we're able to play off that across the organization strategically. And that lets us take this bill of fare to more potential change sponsors and get them invited along to those open spaces and so on. So that's basically, that's how we go about running a full transformation. Any questions?
Thank you, Peter. No, I haven't got a question at the moment. I'm sure I'll get some, but thank you.
No worries.
There's a lot to think about.
I hope so. Well, the recording will go up as soon as possible today. If you've got further questions, then just add them to the post of the recording or add them to the recording on YouTube, and we can cover them over there. The really neat thing about this stuff is that we are a learning ecosystem, us in the XSCALE Alliance, but also us in the festival. We are a learning ecosystem generating learning ecosystems. And if you attended the session on the need for societal agility in the age of COVID and climate change and the 10 death knell technologies we talked about in the Agile in Space session, you'll understand we need to take this stuff further than we even conceived of doing. It's not just business agility first. It's civilization agility first. If we can't get to the point where something like COVID is just something we take in stride rather than something that stops the entire civilization, well, then we're going to get destroyed by the 10 technologies that we talked about in the Agile in Space session. There's a recording for that session is already up as well. So if you missed that, then you can go and see that too. So the point is we're past the point where defending a consultancy or defending a framework and being political about that stuff makes any sense whatsoever. Pull transformation is an enormously valuable way of getting change to happen, and it dramatically reduces risk. So when it comes to selling this stuff, we can go to the sponsor and say, well, this is vastly less risky, vastly cheaper, vastly more effective, vastly easier to control, simpler. Do you want that or do you want this framework? I've yet to find a sponsor who doesn't go, it's less risky and it's cheaper and it's okay, do that.
So Peter, I have to say I cheated because I've been introduced to this since last year by Isam. Isam is my brother.
And, excellent.
And since he was part of the core group and he's always collaborating on this, I always put on my consulting hat and told him at the beginning, he's too complex. They won't understand it. So. Yep. What are the resistances you've had positioning this? Because I can tell you, I can see their eyes and I can see them looking at their watch and say, I'm not going to invest more than 3 minutes in this. I'm going to get rid of this guy.
So you're exactly right. So that's why we have this one slide, because a customer can go, okay, I want some discovery and some inception. I don't want the rest of it. Great. We'll go and do that for you. So that we don't need to sell them all of this stuff. The neat thing from our point of view is we can start with the problems the customer actually has. So to pick on a current example, Kumar Dattatreyan went into College Board and went, okay, well, what sorts of problems do you need fixed with this transformation? And he wound up doing a tailored version of Camelot. They're very, very happy. That's all they need. They don't need to have a whole bunch of other fancy stuff. They got what they wanted. That's all they actually needed in terms of getting their problem solved. Oh my God, I can't believe I'm not thinking of Masa Maeda. It's early in the morning here. I'm not good early in the morning with remembering names. So Masa went into Prada Banco end of 2019. He had a 7-week gig with them. They got turned into a 2-year engagement. And what he did was he went in and he coached leadership as a service into their executive VP team. 13 executive vice presidents who'd never seen eye to eye on anything before were suddenly able to make decisions together that were coherent, that they could make stick. Then he ran a bunch of Game Without Thrones stuff. The point of this is not a framework. We don't need any more frameworks. The whole idea with this stuff is let's go and focus on the actual problems that customers are experiencing and provide them with the least risky, simplest way of solving them we can. Where those problems become problems of scale, let's descale the organization rather than scaling a framework. And this way of growing using pull is the tool we use to do that.
All right, get it. Very smart. Don't delve into the hows and all that stuff. Just show the value.
Yagni. And the neat thing is we can sell them these four chevrons and then so they don't need to see that complicated 3D Kanban. But when they say, well, okay, but you did this, how do I track this? Well, then you show them one three-column Kanban. It's one of those frames. And when they go, well, but how's that happen inside? You go, well, I'll show you the next one. So that way you show them sufficient depth that they get their questions answered. You don't show them any more than that. And the lovely thing then is when you're dealing with the middle or you're dealing with the architects or whatever, you show them a different proscenium. But it all fits into a single, simple, breadth-first scheme. And you don't ever make a big PI planning wall. So there's vastly less complexity in a 3D Kanban than in a PI wall because you only have just the current cutting edge down to a story level. If we go backwards a slide, there's only a few little cards here. We've got maybe a few dozen cards on the wall for our whole organization transformation. And we keep it like that. Every one of these swim lanes might be a team in the middle, and maybe there are some broader swim lanes for streams and programs and portfolios and so on. But again, we don't need to track things at a level that is more complex than our customers want to hear about.
Yep. So do you have illustrations of this as kind of simple games for hypothetical changes? And let's say, I don't know, we've got an invasion of... Okay, virus would be too complicated. Let's say,
something that's kind of like the Game of Thrones scenario where there's an army of the dead that is about to come and invade, and we need to build up a bunch of fortifications and armies. Would that work?
Yeah. I was thinking more even simpler, like changing the position of my food truck and looking at what I have to do with my... you know, my trusted customers, etc. But yeah, zombies are cool.
So that's what we are doing in March with the Games Without Thrones. It's a 2 to 3 hour workshop where we get to play doing this stuff.
Paula invited me several times and I put it on my calendar to keep looking for the new events on XSCALE.
We have an automated version that we're intending to use James Gorman is a coach in Australia who's also very technically skilled, and he's put together some really neat support using Discord and Miro for those games, because obviously we can't use Lego in a lockdown state. so that's what we're doing.
Very cool.
No worries.
I'm going to go catch some sleep.
Please get some rest. Thanks for coming to the festival. Thanks for coming to the session. And I hope you'll come along to the XSCALE Games Without Thrones next month.
Definitely.
Thank you all.
Bye-bye.
Fantastic. Thank you, Peter.